to worship you. We come before you now. We're asking you to show us who you are. Let us leave all the things that keep us from you outside this place today. Oh Lord, we come to worship you. Oh Lord, we come to worship you.
Hi, I am not Pastor Jeremy, if you didn't figure that out. He and his family are enjoying a well-earned vacation at Disneyland. So that's really neat. My name is Van Duval. Let's see here. Pastor Jeremy asked me to MC today, and that stands for, of course, Master of Church. And as you know, we are in the midst of a very special season. And of course, that's March Madness, right? So, how's your bracket? Mine's... right on. How about St. Peter's, huh? And of course, we are here on the fourth Sunday of Lent. And welcome to all of you here in person and in the World Wide Web to worship this week. Jeremy is a chief's joy officer, but of course that makes sense that he's at the happiest place on earth, right? Spreading his joy. And thank you for allowing me to help guide church today. I'm grateful and it's an honor. Let us stand for our opening hymn, More Like You, as the acolytes bring in the light of Christ.
More like you, Jesus, more like you. Fill my heart with your desire to make me more like you. More like you, Jesus, more like you. Touch my lips with holy fire and make me more like you. Lord, you are my mercy. Lord, you are my grace. All my deepest sins have forever been erased. Draw me in your presence. Lead me in your ways. Long to bring you glory in righteousness and praise. More like you, Jesus, more like you. Fill my heart with your desire to make me more like you. More like you, Jesus, more like you. Touch my lips with holy fire and make me more like you.
Now's the time for the holy act of listening as we share our joys and concerns. And Betty, just let me know that we have none online right now, but those will be posted later, or if there are any. There are a couple of prayers here that were turned in. Please put Bob Hendrickson, his son Eric Henderson, in your prayers. Currently in the hospital for possible surgery as he battles Crohn's disease. Thank you. And the other one here is, thank you everyone for your prayers, cards, and many concerns over my recent health problems. I believe I'm on the way to improvement, and with your help, God is with me. Rich Frost. All right, Rich, of course, prayers for full healing. We love you. All right, that was it for prayers. Now we're going to have our special music with Kimberly. Room at the Table. Actually, you know what? I forgot to say a prayer. Can we be in attitude of prayer, please, before we get to that song? This is breathe, relax, be present with God. Here we are, God, gathered in your name. We ask you to please bring peace to the world, to help the people of Ukraine and Russia. Be with Rich Frost, Eric Henderson, in their journeys to health. We come to you humbly, loving you with all our heart, all of our mind, all of our soul, and all of our strength. Let us also love our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, we are here to serve you and praise you and serve our fellow humans. You, Lord, the greatest among us, came not to be served, but to serve. Let everything we say, everything we do, and everything we think be pleasing to you, Lord. We thank you for your mercy and your grace as we say the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, now how about some special music? Kimberly.
Okay, I'm on. There we go. Bill Oleg Mueller brought me this song quite a while back, and I keep looking for a good place to put it. And today I thought, as we talk about habits and vices, maybe it's a good reminder that there's always room at the table for everyone. Let our hearts not be hardened to those living in the margins. There is room at the table for everyone. This is where it all begins. This is how we gather in. There is room at the table for everyone. Too long we have wandered, burdened and undone. There is room at the table for everyone. This is how it all begins. Let us sing the new world in. There is room at the table for everyone. There is room for us all, and no gift is too small. There is room at the table for everyone. There's enough if we share. Come on, pull up a chair. There is room at the table for everyone. No matter who you are, No matter where you're from, there is room at the table for everyone. Here and now we can be the beloved community. There is room at the table for everyone. There is room for us all, and no gift is too small. There is room at the table for everyone. There's enough if we share. Come on, pull up a chair. There is room at the table for everyone. There is room for us all, and no gift is too small. There is room at the table for everyone. There's enough if we share. Come on, pull up a chair. There is room at the table for everyone. Let our hearts not harden to those living in the margins. There is room at the table for everyone. There is room at the table for everyone. There is room at the table for everyone. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Well, howdy there, friends.
Hey.
Oh, Ashley, who took the down out of your pillow?
Oh, I just had a bad weekend.
Oh. Hey, I thought you had a big flying team event this weekend.
Yeah. We had a scrimmage.
And?
It just didn't go very well.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did you guys lose?
No, but I had to sit out half the time on penalties. I mean, flying is supposed to be fun. How can anyone have any fun with all these stupid rules?
Well, hold on there, buddy. Ashley, sometimes we need rules.
Why? They're so annoying. Dragons can breathe fire, you know. So what's wrong with a few excited puffs during the match? Nobody got hurt.
Well, I think sometimes the rules are there to, you know, help everything work better.
What? How?
Well, God's rules helps everyone get along and, you know, learn how to treat each other. You know, like the rule to love God, love neighbor, and love yourself.
Yeah, but I thought Jesus also spent a lot of time telling people not to be all obsessed with rules. Like those Pharisee guys. Nobody likes the Pharisees, and it's because they were way too into the rules.
Okay, well, you kind of got me there. I'll give you that. But it's like today's scripture, you know? Paul is talking about how even everything might be allowed, but not everything is beneficial.
Still not getting how this applies to flying competitions.
Well, I think if you can think of it like, okay, you're right. Just making rules for the sake of rules isn't always the best thing.
See?
But if the rules are there from someone we trust, maybe there's a good reason. So, Ashley, you think maybe there's a reason for flying rules?
Well, the ref maybe did say something about safety once or twice or a bunch of times. Okay, maybe I should reconsider this whole rules thing.
Yeah, they're usually there for a reason.
You know what? That actually kind of makes me feel better. I was thinking that the rules were there to pick on me and make things harder, but maybe it really is better when we all follow the same rules.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, especially when some of the spectators are flammable.
Huh. Fair enough. Okay, buddy. Thanks. Hey, will you say a prayer with me before we go?
Absolutely. You guys want to pray with us?
Can we pray?
Let's pray.
Good morning, God.
Good morning, God.
Thank you for guiding us.
Thank you for guiding us.
And loving us.
And loving us.
And giving us rules.
And giving us rules.
And people to help us with the rules.
And people to help us with the rules.
To help us live our best lives.
To help us live our best lives.
And have fun.
And have fun.
And be safe.
And be safe.
And keep loving you.
And keep loving you.
Amen.
Amen.
Bye, guys.
All right. Bye, everybody.
No, it's you're up. You are up. It says special music by Kimberly. Who I am? Who am I?
That's me.
Who I am? Who am I?
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. And you've told me who I am. I am yours. not because of who I am, but because of who you are. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I am yours. I am yours.
Read our scripture.
Good morning. Today's scripture is from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 14 through 27. Therefore, my dear friends, flee from the worship of idols. I speak as to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we, who are many, are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Consider the people of Israel. Are not those who eat the sacrifices partners in the altar? What do I imply then? That food sacrificed to idols is anything? Or that an idol is anything? No, I imply that what pagans sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. I do not want you to be partners with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Or are we provoking the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he? All things are lawful, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Do not seek your own advantage, but that of others. Eat whatever is sold in the meat markets without raising any question on the grounds of conscience. For the earth and its fullness are the Lord's. If an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you are disposed to go, eat whatever is set before you without raising any questions on the ground of conscience. This is the word of the Lord.
We'll have the message now.
Paul's letter, Paul has a bit of a problem. Paul's job, as we know from his other letters and the book of Acts and those sorts of things, has been to reach out to a new group of people. While the disciples mostly stuck around in the early time of the church in Jerusalem and the surrounding areas and worked primarily with the Jewish population of the day, Paul was one of the first and really the biggest guy to go outside of that area and go and reach what they were known, of course, as the Gentiles. Now, Gentile was basically everybody who wasn't Jewish. So you could be coming from any number of backgrounds, and Paul may be the evangelist that comes to you, comes to your town, comes to your city, and helps set up a church there, a new community there, that is dedicated to learning and living and loving like Jesus. That's basically what Paul did for the second half of his life, as he went around from place to place, really getting progressively further and further away from Jerusalem. And the further away from Jerusalem you get, as you might expect, the more you run into cultures where there are few, if no, kind of Jewish influence on the place. Now, this creates a number of unique problems for Paul that those who remained in Jerusalem didn't really have. In those days, the earliest Christians, the earliest followers of Jesus, also tended for the most part to continue to follow all the other rules and religious expectations that they grew up with. So they were keeping the Sabbath, and they were only, you know, eating the right certain food and washing in a certain way. And they were keeping all of those same practices that they had practiced previously, almost unthinkingly. I mean, because it's what everybody around them was doing, so why would they not? After all, Jesus himself was Jewish. Though, as we know from our Gospels, Jesus also kind of took issue with some of those rules that laid down. Now, Paul is writing to this church, to this community that is made up abundantly and predominantly of non-Jewish folks. And he's writing to them about what the rules and expectations are because they're hearing conflicting things. Paul isn't the only evangelist out there. He's not the only one representing Jesus in these places. Other people have gotten into the mix too and decided to turn in the fun. And some of them are saying things different than what Paul is saying. Some of them are essentially saying, you know, you need to basically, in order to become Christian, you must first become Jewish. In order to become a follower of Jesus, you must do all of the things that Jesus do. And so if Jesus followed these rules, now you need to follow them too. So Paul writes to them and is writing to them about many subjects in several of his letters, trying to help people understand how to navigate those waters. One of the big deal at the time was this idea of idols. Now, we're not talking like American Idol, right? I mean, you know, it's not like idol in terms of somebody like you look up to, or, you know, somebody who means something to you. It's not that sort of thing. They're talking about idols as this things that sort of physically stand in or physically represent a god or a deity or something like that. You know, in the Jewish story, you can think like the golden calf is the best example from Moses' day of God's people choosing to worship an idol instead of a god. And this has always been a challenge and always been a problem that, you know, the God of the Israelites did not like these things. Now, just because Jews at the time didn't have idols and things like that doesn't mean other people did. And in fact, anybody else who was part of the Gentile tradition, whether that's the Egyptian, Greek, Roman, whatever belief system they were part of, probably had as part of their system something that we would and that, you know, Paul himself would probably refer to as an idol, right? There would be a temple or a place where people went. Now, the Jews had a temple, obviously. There's a big temple. Jesus went there a lot. But it wasn't understood really. And what was at the heart of the temple was, you know, the holiest of holy places was the place, you know, where the Ark of the Covenant was kept and the Ten Commandments and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. And that was seen as really, really sacred and really, really important. But it wasn't really seen as God, right? The Ark of the Covenant wasn't God. In that way. So it was an important object, but it wasn't an idol in that way. Whereas if you went into a Roman temple or, you know, of which there were many to many different gods, you would go and you would find usually a statue or something like that of that god that would be treated as the god itself in a much more serious way. And that is the kind of idolatry that, you know, God told Moses about. It was the kind of idolatry that the Jews tried to avoid. And there was this understanding that anything to do with that at all, like anything that came from that or was anywhere near that, was a problem. Now, while it would be somewhat easy for early Christians just to avoid, just don't go to the temples. Like, you don't need to do that anymore. If you're looking for blessing, if you're looking for God's ear, you know, you don't need the intermediary of the statue at the temple anymore because of Jesus and this idea of, you know, this kind of personal connection through the Holy Spirit that we have. A different understanding arose. So that was fairly easy for the first kind of converts to deal with. What became more difficult outside of Jerusalem and outside of Israel especially was all of the ancillary things. Because it wasn't just that people went to there, it's that people brought to the temple various things, including the things that they wanted to sell. So, and in that time and in that place, if you were someone who sold food in the market, especially things like meat, you may take your animal to the temple, have the temple, what we would call today, like process it. Basically, the temple will dispatch and kind of portion out the animal in what is what would be considered like a blessed or, you know, more holy way, and then you give it back to you, and then you can represent this not only as just, you know, fine quality meat or grain or whatever that you are selling in your marketplace, but you could represent it as having been blessed by, you know, this god in this temple through this idol, if you were. And so the question was that the early Christians had is like, well, what about that? Right? Is all of that now tainted? Are we not allowed to do anything with any of that? And that's going to become a pretty big problem if so, because again, outside of Jerusalem, pretty much everything you'd find in the market had that, because frankly, temples would compete compete with each other for the work, because there's obviously a fee that goes along with this. So most everything you would encounter in the market would have been blessed in that way in one of these temples, or in some cases they would have even actually brought like an idol out to the market because, you know, they made small versions that could travel and have things blessed there. You can actually see a system similar to today in India and in places where they still practice a temple culture. You can find a lot of objects that you can purchase that were supposedly, you know, blessed by in a certain temple by a certain idol and things like that. And see, people take it very seriously, and people 2,000 years ago took it very seriously. So Paul's people have a problem. What are we supposed to do with that? Because you're telling us on one hand we're not supposed to do idols and that sort of thing, but on the other hand, that's all we have around here. And this presents Paul with a great opportunity, and actually an important opportunity that we still benefit from today. And what he's trying to help people understand in this passage is a couple of things. Now, first of all, when Paul talks about demons, right, what he's meaning is all these other gods, right? He's saying, you know, that... You know, he's not saying that's just a statue or anything like that. He's talking about, you know, when he's talking about the demons, he's talking about all these other gods that all these other belief systems have that Paul doesn't believe in and doesn't want his people to believe in. So that's what he means by that. And so he gets to give those early Christians and thus us a new understanding about how we approach these things. And what he's saying here, Beth, basically, is in idolatry, the idol isn't really the problem. The fact that the idol is there, the fact that the temple is there and exists, that isn't actually the problem. So that means the food isn't actually the problem. The problem is, what does it mean? And specifically, what does it mean to you? Because he says in this passage, for the earth and its fullness are the Lord's. He's going back to the creation story where basically says, it's all been created by God, right? Everything around us has been created by God. You and I have been created by God. The animals and the things and the worms in the ground and the grain that comes out of the fields has all been created by God. And so, and that cannot be taken away. So the problem isn't that somebody took this to an idol. The problem is what do you believe about that? If you just believe that it's something that it just happens, right? If it's something that just happened, but it is not something you're putting your faith into, if it's not something you're putting your trust into, you know, if you're keeping your faith and your trust where it belongs, your faith and trust in God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit, then it actually doesn't matter. The idol isn't the problem. It's how people feel about it, and it's how you feel about it that's the problem. And what he begins to open up is this whole different understanding of faith, right? That to live a good life, to live a faithful life, isn't to make sure that you've checked all these boxes of do's and have not checked any of the don't boxes, right? He's trying to move people past this idea that there's a rule for everything and all you have to do is follow that rule and you'll be okay, which is really, really fascinating for Paul to do. Paul, who once called himself the Pharisees' Pharisees, because that was the Pharisees' jam. It's what they did. They were all about the rules, right? And when there weren't enough rules in the scriptures, they went and just made some more so that everyone could have the checklist to follow. He's saying, you know what? Actually, that checklist, that thing that I dedicated my entire life to before this time, maybe that's not the way to do it, that it isn't about memorizing a bunch of rules and making sure that you're following it. It's about where your heart is. It's about what you believe about them. It's about what your intention is at the moment. And what's interesting is he's doing it here with the idols, which, if you're remembering back to your Ten Commandments, really comes in and is part and parcel of number one and number two. Commandment number one, you shall not have any gods before me, and you shall not make for yourselves any idols, right? That's the number one that's the number one thing that God is worried about, is that they, people will have gods other than him. And so Paul is reminding him, like, look, that rule isn't about not having little statues, you know, in your home or whatever it is. That rule is about making sure you know whose you are, who it is whose image you're made in, who it is that loves you, and that you prioritize loving them back above anything else. And in many ways, you can kind of keep going through the commandments and see the same thing happen over and over and over again. The commandment that Jesus loved to take on more than anything in his time and in his story was the Sabbath. Right? Jesus was constantly doing things that by the letter of the law of the time were not allowed on the Sabbath, including healing people. And of course, he talks about how is that even possible? How is it even possible that it is ever not okay to offer healing and hope to people, especially on the Sabbath, and especially on God's day? And Jesus will even say, you know, humans were not made for the Sabbath, but Sabbath was made for the humans, right? What's important about the Sabbath is what it means to us. And so for us today, we look at that rule, you shall keep the Sabbath and keep it holy. What does that mean? It means that we should find a time, a regular time, a scheduled time to rest and reconnect with God. Both those things. Sabbath is about both those things. Sabbath isn't just about resting, but it is about that. But it's about resting and reconnecting with God. That is what it is for. And if all you're doing is saying, well, if all you're doing on the Sabbath is saying, well, I only walked so many steps and I stayed home and I followed all the checklist things, then you're not doing the Sabbath right. The most important thing is what you mean by Sabbath when you take it. And what we need to mean is, are we resting and are we reconnecting with God? Now, I don't think I can help you out much on the adultery one. I think that one pretty much stands. But even the one about bearing false witness, sometimes telling the truth isn't actually the best thing to do. The idea of not bearing false witness isn't a call to absolute candor, right? Sometimes, you know, we tell a little less than the truth in small ways to protect somebody's feelings, right? To protect a relationship. Sometimes we tell less than the truth for big ways. I think about the brave souls who sheltered Jews in their house during the Holocaust. They lied to people all the time about what they were doing, but they did it for a good reason. The truth is, sometimes, in order to live faithfully, sometimes for our stories to be written in the way that God wants them to be written, we actually have to break the rules. Sometimes in big, spectacular ways, sometimes in small ways. Sometimes the rules we have to break are written down and well-known. Sometimes, though, the rules come in a more subtle form. They come in the form of tradition, or we've always done it that way, or That's not how we do things here. And that crops up in all sorts of places, not just at church and not just at workplaces and not just in government and all sorts of things, but in all sorts of places. Some of the best examples of this actually come from the art community. Edgar Degas, when he painted in the late 19th century and early 20th century, he developed a very interesting style that for us today would look fairly old-fashioned, no doubt, but at the time was groundbreaking. And what made his style groundbreaking is that he really adopted this sort of like snapshot version of composition. The truth is Degas was really informed by this brand new technology of the time called photography. And one of the amazing things that photography could do, especially as it got progressive, when photography first came out, it would take a while, so you had to stand very still, which is why the earliest pictures are always people looking very stoic, standing still, and not smiling at all. Because that's a pose you could hold for several seconds while the camera did what it did. As time went on and photography got faster and faster and faster, suddenly it could do this really amazing things. Suddenly you could take snapshots. You could take pictures of people in action, in movement. You could take candid pictures. And of course, our Facebook feeds and Instagram feeds are full of nothing, probably, but candid pictures of things. And we don't think anything of it. But at one time, it was revolutionary. And Degas saw that. And he saw what was going on there. And he started to adopt it in how he painted. So he began to paint these paintings that were not people posed in particular positions, but were more people being in a moment in time. And this other radical thing where he had characters, he had people in the pictures that would get slightly cut off at the edges, something that's common in photographs, always been common in photographs, that somebody's moving in and out of the shot, but was almost unheard of in painting, where you have time to frame things. So what does it mean to compose a picture that way? And Degas, who we would say today is a master and somebody that modern painters look up to and whose paintings sell for millions and millions of dollars, at the time was considered a rule breaker and a radical, and people weren't sure if they liked it. And of course, the biggest example of all this is going to be Picasso. Picasso, we would look back and probably say is one of the best, the most brilliant artists to ever live. Rivaling, the classics of the Renaissance and really ushering in a whole new understanding of art and art is what it could be. Some of Picasso's earliest works, because it received such a negative attention in the beginning, he hid away and hid away for years. Works that now would be literally priceless, that we could not put a number on how important they were, but because he continued to play with the rules about about proportions and depth and what things could look like or do look like, because he wasn't trying to be accurate in terms of what they looked like, but was trying for something different, something else. At the time, he was considered a rule breaker. He was doing something different, and people weren't sure if they liked it. Paul is giving us a new way to understand our faith and faithfulness and how we evaluate how we are doing. Now, the part of the problem with what Paul's doing is he's taking it from being something that is actually fairly easy. Just go through the list. Did I do? Did I not do? And making it something a little more difficult. He's asking us to make judgment calls. Judgment calls about what we do, judgment calls about how we spend our time, judgment calls about what we think, how we think about things. And he's asking us to evaluate what we do, not by some black and white standard, but by a different one. And of course, that standard becomes, as we know it today, is this thing that I'm doing, is this thing that I'm thinking, is this thing I'm participating in, is this thing that I'm investing my time, my energy, my money into, is it helping me love God, love my neighbor, and love myself? That is the judgment call we are asked. If we to avoid idolatry, it's not that we're not going to have things in our lives that mean something to us, but it means that we should probably not have things in our lives that mean so much to us, that are so important to us, that they in many ways become that thing that we worship. We can have things that we love, things that we care about, things that we want to invest time and energy into, absolutely. Those of us who are like me and enjoy the sound of an internal combustion engine and four wheels on the ground enjoy, you know, washing the car and putting the top down. That's okay, so long as we know why we're doing it. For me, some of the best self-care that I have, which of course is the buzzword of all buzzwords today, some of the best self-care I have is on a nice warm sunny day is to put the top down and head into the mountains and drive through the curves and to feel the world around me, maybe usually with the music off. You know, that's one of the most loving acts for myself that I can do. And it's even better when there's a friend sitting next to me and we can enjoy the ride and we can enjoy the time and we can enjoy the conversation with each other and we can do it in a way that is free from the distractions of our phones and all the rest of the world has to do. That's a sacred act. The car is not my idol. The time that it gives me, the opportunity that it gives me to be with God and be with others, that is what's important. So when we think about the stories of our lives, when we think about our own autobiography and who we are, when we think about all of those things, let's look back on our own story and say, when were those times that things were the most important to us? When were those times when things seemed to break through in a new way? They may be a time when maybe we weren't breaking a rule, but maybe we were breaking an expectation. An expectation that others had for us or an expectation that we had for ourselves. Because when we are about that, when we find those moments in our story and cultivate those moments of our story, when we ask ourselves those questions, you know, why do I keep doing the things that I do? Why am I about the things that I am about? Are they helping me love God, love neighbor, love myself? Am I should I investing my time, my energy, my money, and my resources differently than I am? Can I do more? More for God, more for my neighbor, and more for me? When we are about those questions and we are breaking free of those expectations, then we are about writing the story that God wants us to write. Because the truth is, today is different than what it was Paul's days 2,000 years ago. Most of us are not worried about whether or not our food has been sacrificed to idols or anything like it. Most of us are not really worried about breaking free of a lot of oppressive rules that others are trying to put on us. That is the blessing of living in a free and open society. What we are likely challenged with, I know I'm challenged with, is breaking free of the expectations I've set for myself. The rules that I built up in my own minds about how I am to be or how I am supposed to be. And instead finding a different way through, allowing myself the grace, remembering that I am part of the earth and its fullness. So I belong to the Lord like you do, and we all do. And that because of that, we are good because we are made in God's good image. So let us find in those stories those places where we need to break free, those places where we need to let go of old expectations that no longer serve us. Let us instead embrace the calling, the more difficult task of asking ourselves the question over and over again, how am I doing? Loving God, loving neighbor, loving myself. How might I do better? Amen.
Please join me. You can stand up, sorry.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear believed. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior,
has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
I'm going to step out of the bounds of rules. Kimberly, would you come up here? Since we're stepping out of the bounds of rules here, would you hold these and stand next to me here, please?
Oh. Get in here. Come over here.
This side. This side. Get
this
over
side.
Here. Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
With everybody.
Hold on. Everybody smile. See if my fingers work for this.
There you go.
All right. Thank you. Now we have some announcements here. All right. Okay, Rum and Sail returning. The dates are Friday, May 6th, and Saturday the 7th. There'll be more details in the newsletter. Please don't drop off any items before May 2nd. They will not accept furniture, electronics, or baby equipment. Baby clothes and toys are accepted. Easter Sunday is at 10 a.m. on the South Lawn. Bring your own chair, BYOC, bring your own chair. We also need to ask for Easter egg hunt candy. We still need those donations. And let me get back to my notes. There's a text from Nicole about this. Let me get that and I'll read it. Let's see here. So the Easter egg hunt's on April 16th. And we need volunteers for the Easter egg hunt on that day. There'll be a list of people to sign up, for people to sign up for the event at the Easter egg hunt. So there's that. And I believe that's it for announcements. Our closing benediction. Lord, we thank you for all of the wonderful blessings that you give us. We are grateful as we lift up your name. Let us go among your world and shine your light and live by your example. May the peace and grace of God be with you as we go out into the world. Amen.
Take, oh, take me as I am. Summon out what I shall be. Set your seal upon my heart and live in me.